We've got a oryx. We've got a bear booty. Just thank you for that, buddy. Hey folks, this is Best in Slot and welcome to Planet Zoo Console Edition for the Xbox Series S, the Series X, and the PlayStation 5. And that's what you're looking at right here. This was all recorded on my PS5. I was lucky enough to get early access to the game, and then unlucky enough, stupid enough, to get locked out of my PlayStation account. So this was all a little bit last minute, I'm not gonna lie, I did all of this today. But I set myself a limit, 2 hours to build a zoo. So we've got two exhibits and some mini exhibits, and there's some blueprints involved, don't get me wrong, but and I know that's a lie before anyone comments. But yeah, everything you're looking at here was built and put together in 2 hours, and that includes learning the controls for console edition. So for the first 5-6 minutes of this video, I'm going to give you a tour of that little zoo I built, this one right here. And then I've recorded also the process of building this zoo. So we're going to go back and we're kind of going to segment the building process into various different bits. You know, barriers, paths, advanced tools, animals, etc., etc. And I'll give you the good points and the bad points, what can maybe use some improvement, etc. And hopefully give you a good overview of how console edition for Planet Zoo functions. If you're just looking for the Cole's notes, I suppose, it's really good. I'm actually really, really impressed. So I came into this with two main, not concerns, but things I was curious about. Number one was the control scheme. Planet Zoo is quite a complex game. How does it function with a console control scheme? Secondly is the zoo complexity meter, which is basically a bar that goes up as you add new zoo animals and as you add new items to your zoo. And if it reaches 100%, you can't breed new animals. So your zoo's kind of done at 100%. So I had some concerns about how strict that was going to be, and if I could continue to build zoos in the way I usually do. If you look at this Bengal tiger exhibit that I built here, this is the non-blueprint one I did, you'll see there's grass everywhere. There's trees sunk down into the ground, there's a billion rocks, there's a little car over on the left. I really tried to build this exhibit the way I would usually build a zoo exhibit. I didn't see the point, I do like tigers, I didn't see the point of coming on and building a specific type of exhibit for the console edition. I wanted to build how I would usually build, and that means trees in the ground, and that means grass. Loads of foliage, and terrible path placement, annoyingly. This one you're looking at, this warthog exhibit, is actually from the workshop, so the console editions are going to have their own workshop. There was only one item in there, shared by someone else who's got early access, assumedly, but they built a little warthog habitat and I downloaded that, and that all seemed to work perfectly. I'll talk a bit more about that later on, but there is the zoo. So 2 hours, not bad, considering I was learning the controls, and the middle bit was all me, the rest is kind of blueprints, but yeah, as you can see, a lot of grass, and that's very exciting, because if we go into settings, and there you go, there is your zoo complexity meter, 7%. So what that means is you could build a zoo on console edition that's about, what, 14 to 15 times bigger than the zoo I've built here, and the game would function absolutely fine. We're going to talk a little bit more about that later on in the video, but this was the most impressive part of Planet Zoo to me, was simply that the complexity meter just was fine, handled it really well. Like I said, I'll go into a little bit more detail when we get to that segment. But safe to say, the complexity meter is less of a concern now than it ever was in the past. But as I say, we'll dig into a little bit more detail in a little bit. There's my lovely tiger having a chillax in my buffalo grass. I don't have my beloved Yorkshire grass. The so I obviously very thankful I got early access to the game. They didn't give me the DLC though. I was a little bit like, I keep seeing all these limited DLC items on my in my item list. Anyways, what we're doing now, this is how I started. So I recorded the entire building process. We're gonna time lapse at the very start because this took quite a while. I was kind of just figuring controls out. Here's all the settings and stuff like that, and then it'll slow down a little bit and we'll break it down into individual segments in just a moment. I didn't check out the campaign and stuff like that because I wasn't, you know, it's the same campaign, it's going to function correctly. So really all I was interested in was the controls and the sandbox limitations, because that's what matters to me as a builder. I would expect challenge mode and campaign to function exactly as they did on the PC at the end of the day. Oh, but you can see here, we've got all the blueprints. You know, if you are a beginner builder, you're trying to, you know, you've got access to Planet Zoo for the first time, definitely check out the Frontier blueprints that were included with the game. You know, learn how to put buildings together and stuff like that. you know, take your time just to familiarize yourself with the controls. Ignore what I'm building here. This was me, again, just figuring things out on a very basic level on how you build things. We'll be deleting this and skipping forward any second now. There we go. We're going to build the things. So let's really talk about the controls initially. So it is hard to start. There's a lot. At the end of the day, they're complex controls, right? You know, this is not a simple game. And figuring out where everything is initially a little bit of a pain, because all aspects of the controller have to be utilized. Because at the end of the day, you have far less buttons on the controller than you do on the PC. If you look in the top left, you'll see that it actually utilizes the touchpad in the middle of the PS5 controller. So you hold the touchpad, and you press T to get to that top left section. You press R3 to access that section. You press square and then other buttons to access the delete key and all this kind of, there's a lot going on basically. But I will say, as much as I struggled initially, as you'll see, by the end of the 2 hours, I was kind of there. You know, there's definitely more hotkeys and little combos I could learn. But as frustrating as I found this initial period, as like, you know, because my brain's wired for the PC version, as annoying as this initial version was, things like that, you know, just learning how to mesh things together into a single group was pretty bloody easy. And by the end of the session, I was just throwing things down all over the place. That's not to say the controls are perfect. I do have some criticisms that we'll get into throughout the video. But generally speaking, I'm pretty impressed. I really thought it was going to be more disastrous than it turned out to be. And already at this point, I was thinking, well, I'm doing all right. I'm going to get rid of the line though. So, pathing. This is actually one of the areas I was having a problem. As you can see, like, I could not get rid of this little bit on the left-hand side. So, one of the problems with the pathing, the main problem I have with the pathing, and I don't think this will surprise anyone, I think Planet Zoo's main issue has been pathing for a long time, really. It's just not a great system. It isn't much better on the console, I'm afraid. It was very frustrating. But really only with elevated paths. The way you swap between gridded or unattached paths is pretty great. It works really well. The problem is when you want to build an elevated path, if you hold the... Basically, if you look into the... When I'm building path again, if you look towards the bottom, it says you hold square to make an elevated path. And that's what you do. You just hold square and you lift your analog stick upwards and it builds an elevated path. The problem is, as you just saw there, it kind of raises above where your cursor is. So you can never... How do I describe this? You can't raise it and then move it. You have to pick the exact right position, basically. And it makes it really, really annoying. I kept looking for like little additions that were going to help. I figured, oh, maybe I'm missing something here. But no, they're just slightly obnoxious, it must be said. Elevated paths were one of the more annoying aspects. Everything else is fine. Regular pathing felt pretty good. Again, you just kind of have to learn all the little buttons that you need to press, you know, stuff like that. But this was a problem for me because I wanted to elevate the path to the left, but as you can see, it's automatically connecting. Barriers were largely the same in that they were really good, except one small issue, which I'll talk about in just a second, but they were okay. Yeah, you've got all the same sort of things that you've got on the console, on the PC edition, I should say. There's a slight bug at the moment where one-way glasses opened up early for people, but that'll be fixed by release, I'm sure. The only problem I had was, you know where you have the, you got the little plinths between each fence? Changing the texture of those was really, really difficult. Like, I had a hedgerow one at one point, I just couldn't get rid of the bloody thing. I kept clicking it and changing the barrier type and nothing would change. And that was pretty annoying. But other than that, works really well. Again, works exactly like the console edition. Got all the same sort of options. You've got all your different angles, you've got all your different length modifiers, stuff like that. Again, it's just one of those things that takes a little bit of time to get used to, and I think a lot of people playing this for the first time are going to get frustrated, and I implore you to just stick with it, you know, just stick with it, give it some time. A couple of hours is all it took. I mean, okay, I've got a lot of experience on the PC version. I'm not sure that helps that much, except I know what the game is capable of. And I will say, one of the beautiful things about this is that whilst you do have to get used to a new control scheme, you aren't limited at all, really, compared to the PC version. It's just the same thing, but on console. The only limitation, really, is the lack of all the DLCs, and of course the lack of the complexity meter, but that doesn't seem to be that big a limitation. We'll talk about that later on. Again, terrain working exactly the same way you would expect. And you know, I really thought what I was going to do, I was going to split this into... I haven't scripted this in case I was not painfully obvious. I was going to split this into all these different sections and I'd have lots to say. But I don't have anything to say on terrain. Terrain worked really well. It worked exactly like it does on the console. It was nice and easy to control. It's not as quick, obviously. It's just going to slow you down. But if you're here to figure out whether the... Right, basically, if you can play Planet Zoo on PC... I'm always going to suggest that. There are a lot of benefits to that. But if you're here to learn if playing the console version works, and if you'll be able to build a good zoo, and if you'll be able to enjoy yourself, then me just saying, yeah, this works well, I guess is all you really need to know. Terrain works really well. The animal market, again, it has this issue in that there's a billion buttons to press, and it can be a little confusing sometimes to know which button you need to press to get to which part of the UI. You know, if you're playing on PC, you just move your mouse to the appropriate location, it's much easier. Because there's such complexity in the console edition, because there's such complexity in the console edition of the game, very often you're going to not quite know what button to press to get to each area. It's definitely always highlighted, but to build that into your muscle memory, it's going to take a bit of time. All the animals I saw looked pretty good, I think. There's not really been any changes. It's still got that lovely little fur shader. Very low key on that, but looks great. Sounds, animations. I had the sound turned off by accident. You just saw the annoying barrier I couldn't get rid of. And then scenery. So again, like I said, I wanted to build exactly how I usually would. This was actually my main problem with the scenery. You're just kind of seeing it in action here. The sensitivity. So basically, you've got an item in your hand. You can turn on random rotation and all that kind of jazz. It does keep defaulting to 12.5 angle snap. I'm not sure why. But I found that the height adjustment, you hold square and you move the analog stick up and down. It's very, very sensitive. It's very, very hard to move it a tiny bit. You have to basically just edge it a teeny tiny bit. And then it'll work. But it's overly sensitive. What you just saw there, I should explain. Basically, my PlayStation crashed, not because of Planet Zoo, but because I kicked out the power, because again, very intelligent. And this was the autosave. So you can see how much I lost. It saved a couple minutes ago. I don't know. Okay, so lots of exhibit buildings happen there. It's just pointing down foliage. There's really nothing to it. But by the end of that exhibit, by the end of that first exhibit, I felt so much more comfortable. I was still having problems with the height movement. And I think that probably needs tweaking. It is too sensitive. You have to be so gentle with it. It's crazy. But other than that, can't say I had any problems. And I've got some exciting stuff coming up about... I had random rotate on there, as you can see. Had some exciting stuff about the scenery and stuff like that. We'll get to that in a little bit. But here you can see how advanced move works. So you've got your various options and then you've got your active axis. So you go up to there and you kind of scroll through which axis you want to move your items on. Here, multi-select, you go around, you click on each individual item, and then you can select them into a group, you can select them as a blueprint, etc., etc. And then advanced moves that group, as you can see here, and you see I'll tab through the different axes, and then we're going to swap to rotate and do the same thing. You can tab through the various axes. It works. It's definitely slower. You're not instantly tabbing around, you're not using hotkeys to do all this. It's always going to be slower. And I will say... whilst I found scenery quite easy to do, and I'm sure some other console players will turn up and make me look very stupid saying this, I would be hesitant to do a very complex piece of building. I think you can definitely do some cool buildings. I wouldn't want to build something super complex, just because it would take ages. I'm not saying you couldn't do it, you definitely could. I would find it a little bit frustrating just because of the amount of time. But in part, that's because I'm used to the PC version as well. If you're not, if this is new to you, if you're just a console-only player, you know, you'll kind of normalize that length of time and probably adjust appropriately. And I will say, again, like with everything else, once I kind of got used to the controls a little bit more, this whole process did become a lot easier. You can see I can just kind of grab the whole group there and move it around as you would normally expect in Planet Zoo, with not really any problems at all. It just took a little bit more time and a little bit more practice. But it does work. So, waterfalls. I'm not sure why this is a thing, but waterfalls, anyways, as you see, not allowed that. I know why waterfalls is here. So I had three primary problems building in console edition. The first was the paths being annoying. The second was the height sensitivity. The third is what you'll see in a second. So I'm building this waterfall, just plopping all these around. That all works fine, looks great, you know, no lag problems, anything like that. But you'll see in just a second, hopefully, if I've included it, let me just sit this waterfall down. Beautiful waterfall. You'd have to go, this would take a bit of time as well, you'd have to go from move to advanced move and pull it out more directly like that. But yeah, other than that, nice and easy. And then I accidentally put one, I'll just talk about it because it's not happened yet. I accidentally put one on the tree. So my problem is, so the way you undo in this game is you hold square and then you tap left on the D-pad. I think it's that combination. When did I put it on the tree? I swear I put one on the tree. Anyways, there it is. So you hold square and then you tap left on the D-pad. And the problem is, if you're not on the home screen, I guess, if you've not got rid of all your other UI elements, if you're on like the basic Planet Zoo gameplay screen, that combination doesn't work. It doesn't matter if square isn't doing anything else, that still doesn't work. So if you make a mistake like I just made, you have to back out of everything, hold square and back. Obviously you can go in and delete, but sometimes that's a little bit difficult. Maybe you're sinking things on the ground, or it's a waterfall, you know, with the tiny little machinery. So undo not being accessible all the time was quite annoying, and very often I had to back out of the entire UI, undo, go back through the entire UI kind of thing. So that was the third annoyance. I'm not saying any of these are big problems. They definitely didn't get in the way of me being able to build a zoo or really enjoy my time. It's just, it was a slight annoying. And you're going to see the height problems here. I was kind of getting used to it at this point just by, you know, you don't always have to go hard. Just go gentle. Just take your time. It's fine. I was trying to decide where this is going to be, but this is from the workshop, as I say. So console players will be able to do their builds and share them between themselves. And I'm actually really excited to see what console players can come up with, because I've said that the building's slower and a bit more complex, and it is for sure. But I've got no doubts people will be able to build some really, really cool things. And I'm really excited to see what people come up with. And I think we might come back in a week or two and see what things people have managed, because I'm sure people will show me up in no time at all. But someone built a really nice warthog enclosure, and a little bit of stuff here on exhibit animals, just kind of showing you how it works, really, how this UI works. You go around, you adopt all your animals, you can heart them, usual kind of stuff. All works okay, yeah. Really, no concerns on this one. It's 7 a.m. I don't have anything to say at 7 a.m. I'm sure other people have been much more helpful than I, but I just want to show you every aspect of the building aspects. Every building aspect, and just point out issues I had more than anything else. Because it's worth noticing, when I say these negatives, when I say these issues, I'm coming from a base place of, this works. You know, by and large, it ran really well, it functioned really well, I had a good time. Here's the problems. Like, you can take, if I don't mention it, you can take it as a positive kind of thing. And I do still have a big positive to talk about, as I've mentioned, including the boa constrictors. And also, you can get really close in on exhibit mode on console. I think you have more sort of smooth motion control with a controller, of course, because it's just a little bit more, it's a little bit smoother. All the text is gigantic, as you may have seen. But there's our lovely exhibit animals living there. Lovely exhibit animal life. Now, what I wanted to do, so I built that entire zoo, 7% complexity, as I say. And my theory was, because, right, I started to put the grass down, and I put all the buffalo grass down, and we're talking probably 100 to 200 pieces of buffalo grass, if not more. And all the, I did basically the entire exhibit, and the complexity meter moved from 7%. To 7%. So my theory was, it's the animals, right? That maybe they're culling scenery items. So basically, if the scenery isn't on screen, it doesn't, basically that they're not including scenery in complexity much. I think it would take a lot of scenery to really raise the complexity of your zoo. So I thought, what I'm gonna do, as you can see, is add loads of animals. So I put 28 different species, this was the key as well, 28 different unique species in my Bengal tiger habitat. Built a kind of Noah's Ark kind of shebang, just to see how much damage this would do to the zoo complexity meter, right? Because I forget it's the animal AI that's probably the main thing weighing on the complexity meter more than the scenery items. And as you can see, there's a big variety there. You just saw an orangutan, we've got elephants, camels, there's a Aladabra tortoise, there's an aardvark, there's a flamingo. I just like seeing all these animals popping like this. There's a tapir, I think this is probably near the end now. It's a bear, nope, they're still going. Noah would be proud. Still going. We've got an ostrich up there. There's my tortoise. Aldebra. We've got a oryx. Got a bear booty. Just thank you for that, buddy. So all these animals, 28 new species of animals added into the zoo. Okay? As you can see, packed with guests as well, in case that's relevant. You know, all these animals, and because I've got sandbox settings on, they can all live together in bizarre harmony. Tons of guests packed in to look at them. Going to settings, where do we end up? 11%. I added 28 unique species of animal, and it put it up by 4%. Absolutely crazy, as far as I'm concerned. And if there's one thing, I mean, look at this. I put so much foliage into this exhibit. I really spent time putting the foliage in. I really did. And trying to make it look pretty. And if there's one thing I'll say about this game, it is optimized superbly well for all these animals to come in like that and count for 4%. Yeah, so I've got to give it really good praise. Other than the DLC, I go back and forth on the DLC. I will say that the DLC is cheaper than on PC by quite a large amount if you buy like the Ultimate Edition, but it's a big upfront cost when it's going to take a while to get you all that DLC. But in terms of optimization, tell you what, I'll just leave you on that page while I finish talking so you can see. I mean, look at that. Beautiful. In terms of optimization, in terms of the zoo complexity meter, in terms of how the game handles foliage, in terms of the size of zoo you're going to be able to build, I think especially if you focus on the more natural aspect rather than anything else, it's much less limited than I thought it was going to be. There are 34 or 36 animals in total in this zoo, not including three different types of exhibit animal and of course all the guests. And the exhibit is this detailed and it's still 11%. Now of course that would go more if they were all in separate exhibits. My point really is that you can build... It's not going to be as complex. You're not going to build Elderwood on the console edition. That would be crazy and take a gajillion years. But you can build a really cool zoo and it'll look great. The animals look great. They're animated really well. It ran perfectly. If you can play it on PC, I'm always going to suggest you play it on PC. Tell you what, I'll just let this play because I don't like talking over static. If you can play it on PC, you should play it on PC because you're going to have a lot more control. You've probably got all the DLC already. Blah, 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 blah. But if you want to sit down and chill on the console edition, I think Frontier have done a really, really impressive job with this version of the game. And I came in expecting it to be really obnoxious, and I retain that really complex building is probably going to be annoying. And management aspects could be a little annoying as well with how much you fly around the UI, but I mean, it's the same, I would say, with the console, the PC edition of the game anyway. It's one of those games that rewards time and just getting to know the game, learning the controls, and kind of building that muscle memory. And if you do that, you'll find it easy peasy lemon squeezy. I know I did by the end. Other than not being able to undo, that really annoyed me. The main thing that annoyed me in the entire build was not being able to undo. Anyways, I don't want to prattle on anymore. Planet Zoo Console Edition, I can only recommend it if you've not been able to, if you don't have a PC capable of playing the game and you want to play the game, I wholeheartedly recommend it because you're getting basically the exact same experience, controls really well, plays really well. What more do you need, basically? If any of you have different experiences, do not blame me. Okay, cool. Right, so thank you so much for joining me for this. Let me know down below. What I'm curious about, those of you planning to buy, right, first of all, who is planning to buy this? Are you a first-time player, or are you a PC player who wants to go chill, sit on the couch, and play some Planet Zoo? Because that is tempting to me as well. I could go and put my PS5 in the living room and relax a little bit, play some PC. That sounds really good to me. Bear booty, good place to end. Thank you for joining me. Throw me a like if you enjoyed the video. which is basically me prattling on for 25 minutes. Cheers much of as always. Check out Planet Zoo Console Edition tomorrow. Bye-bye. Oh.